Good morning, teachers, administrators, parents, and district staff. My name is Dave Evelyn, and I'm a director of instruction here in Burnaby. I have the distinct honor to be able to introduce our keynote speaker this morning, Mr. David Boulton. I first had the pleasure of hearing David speak at a Circle of Learning conference in San Antonio this past November. His morning keynote address on reading and on learning in general was memorable, not just for its message, but more so for the emotions that it evoked. I remember turning to my Burnaby colleagues after his address, and the comment was the same from all of us. We need to bring David to Burnaby. David comes to us from his home in Kentucky, where he is the co-producer and creator of the Children of the Code, a project whose mission is to transform how our society thinks about the written language and the challenges involved in learning to read it. It is our good fortune that we are able to hear David this morning as he shares his thoughts, goals, and dreams with us. I am sure that his message today will leave each of us with many important academic and emotional images of learning. Please welcome Mr. David Boulton.
Thank you, David, and thank you all leadership team here at Burnaby. It's just a delight to be here. I understand everybody I've met said, by the way, did you realize that this is the best weather that we have at this time of the year? I mean, it has really been a wonderful and delightful time to be here in Vancouver. And I've had the opportunity to meet with the Leadership Council on my first night, and as Dave mentioned, with some of your administrators, and last night with some of your parents. And this is this is a very unique place. I've traveled and done over 60 of these kind of events around the United States and other parts of Canada. And I have to say that this is a really remarkable community that you've got here. And so it's my delight and honor to be here and to have an opportunity to talk with you. As Dave mentioned, the name of my project is called the Children of the Code Project. There's really two different things to keep in mind when you hear that term. One, children of the code, we are all children of the code. Every one of us sitting here today, in the sense that...
The bottom line of this is that the big step between us and animals is indeed language, but the big step between civilization and more primitive forms of human society is written language.
Human language, when it's not written down, it is primarily speech. It does not have this external objectifiable form on a page so that you can think about it and name it as language and think of it as something that one can set aside or pick up or do things with. Rather, it's something we inhabit. It's a medium we are immersed in, as it were.
It has enormous metacognitive implications. The power is this, that you can not only think in ways that you could not possibly think if you did not have the written word, but you can now think about the thinking that you do with the written word.
Once we start writing, we are able to then reflect back upon what we have written, and we enter into this kind of recursive relation to our own written signs. And so only then a certain degree or experience of self-reflection that we now sort of take for granted comes into being.
I'm saying we're children of the code in the sense that this technology, this greatest invention in the history of history, is now kind of the background of the way everything works. It's embedded in everything about the way the world works, from the design of this building to the clothing we wear to how we navigate the world and our automobile, everything. I mean, what isn't affected by it? On the one hand, it's pretty obvious its impact on the outer world. It's less obvious its impact on the inner world. The way that we remember, the way that we think, the kind of vocabulary we use, and as you just heard, the very kinds of self-reflection that's so common to modern human beings is a consequence of what happened when we became code users. So I mean, when I say children of the code, that's one meaning. The other meaning, and the meaning that's actually more important for a gathering like this, is that whereas we're all children of the code in this big broad brush sense, some of us are children of the code in an entirely different sense. there are millions of children who, by virtue of the kind of early life learning trajectories, by virtue of our general ignorance about reading as a society, for a number of different reasons, hit the wall of this code, and their entire life is mangled and warped and misshapen by the difficulties that they experience popping through it. So, Children of the Code has these two different meanings, and what we're going to do this morning is to talk a little bit about the process of reading and what we call the code and the challenge of learning to read it and how it affects all of us, and then use that as a kind of a rabbit hole to drop deeper into a conversation about learning, which is our main purpose, our main mission, what we call stewarding the health of learning. Before I go any further, I want to say that just as some caveats, I don't mean to insult anybody's intelligence. I know that you're a bright group, so some of the things that I'm going to share are things that you've heard about before. Hopefully what I'm going to do is connect the dots between them in a somewhat different way. I'm not here to sell anything. There's nothing about what I'm doing that's about selling anything, including any ideas in particular. I'm here to thump you into thinking differently in certain ways and to provide a series of resources that after this event, if you're interested, you can go to learn. What I'm going to share with you today is just the little sliver of the work that we've done. We've conducted 120 interviews with scientists and scholars around North America and in some cases around the world that are experts in things ranging from the psychology and emotional health of children that struggle with reading to the cognitive science of the construction and assembly of this simulated language experience in our brain we call reading, to the neuroscience of how sound is assembled in our minds and how the code and the sound processing in our brains work together, to the entire history of writing and how it's changed over time and how the code in the course of its changes has come to represent the kind of challenge it does today for children learning to read. So there's this whole scope. We've conducted over 400 hours of interviews. In addition to the 120 experts, we've talked to about 50 plus kids, and that's growing all the time. And all of this information is available on our website, free for you to use, free for you to share with kids that are struggling to help them better understand what they're going through. So with that as my only commercial, so to speak, I'd like to go back to our conversation about Children of the Code. As I mentioned, we're talking about a system that, since its beginning, has affected everything about the world that we operate in, from the emergence of all of our religious systems to the emergence of Western civilization's fundamental philosophies and sciences, and has been the organizing principle of civilizations ever since the Greeks and ever since spreading out throughout Europe and to the worlds that we operate in today. But as I mentioned, the more important aspect of understanding this effect of the code on our society is to understand what happens to children who struggle with it. So let's start with that.
I would try skipping the reading that I had to do in elementary school. I would get really nervous when I had to read. And it was just I wasn't smart. I thought I was not smart because I couldn't read like everybody else could.
What must it be like to come to school every day, right? And school is going to be all about the thing that you don't do well, that you have found difficult. All right, if I said to you, come to school or come to work 180 days a year, and 80% of the time that you're, at work or at school, wherever you happen to be, I'm going to ask you to do the thing you don't do well, what would you do? What would you do?
Usually I'd read before I read, before they called on me, so I'd just hurry up and read it before they'd call me, so I'd really, know it before I read it. And when they call on me, I'd sometimes be ready for it, and sometimes I wouldn't. And I'd be like, oh my God, she called on me. And sometimes I'd be like, I don't want to read, and they wouldn't care, and then it'd make me, and then I'd be like, oh God.
Spending any amount of time in classrooms where children are working on beginning reading instruction, you can almost watch children who are struggling begin to turn off and exhibit behaviors that are going to interfere with their learning.
The spiral starts, and the learning problems get more intense, the emotional.
So the way that we break it down is that there's a variety of different things that we call what's at stake. that requires an understanding of why reading is so important. I mean, reading is the primary building machinery for extending our vocabulary. Most of the vocabulary of an adult human being comes more from reading than it does from verbal intercourse and dialogue. And you can see that all for yourself, just in terms of the kind of complexity of language that's typically being shared on television or in hanging around the corner kind of conversation compared to the kind of vocabulary that's involved in most of the reading. It's clear to everybody that there's a profound correlation between reading-related difficulties and general academic danger. What's less clear is the emotional danger, the learning-disabling consequences of protracted learning-to-read difficulties that are so often invisible and not understood by the parents and teachers surrounding a child that's struggling with this. We're going to touch on that. This emotional danger leads to social danger. In the United States, literacy scores are used to project how many prison cells to build. The correspondence is so strong, and as we'll see as we go forward, the cause of that correlation is less to do with the fact that these kids can't read in the mechanical sense, that they're unable to get information through writing, and more to do with the side effect. What happens to them when everybody around them is helping them get that this is critically important, yet they're struggling with it, and the consequence of that struggle is self-blame, and the consequence of the self-blame is avoidance, and the consequence of avoidance is a downward spiral of ever less proficiency with reading, and the whole thing just builds on itself, and it leads to, as we'll talk about it multiple times during our time this morning, it leads to children developing mind shame, becoming ashamed of their minds. Just think about what it must be like to go through life ashamed of your mind. Nobody here could really, I mean, you can identify to that to some degree. There must be some aspect of your personal experience, some aspect of the things that you've wanted to learn that show up your shame, that make you feel uncomfortable or not good enough. Imagine when that's day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, what that's doing to you on the inside. That's the reason there's such a strong correlation between everything we measure about prison, juvenile justice problems, and what have you in reading, not just the lack of the skill. So there's so many things that are at stake when we talk about reading. It is a massive learning disabling challenge for millions of children. Probably one of the most interesting things to share here is that in the course of these conversations, I said 120 different experts that we've talked to. We've asked a number of different questions to try to pull a consensus together across all these different disciplines and across all these different sciences that would lead to some kind of a reformation. That's the mission of our project, to create an addition to the knowledge that we have, but a fundamental reframe in our understanding of what's involved in learning to read. And it's really critical. And in the course of that, there's a section here that I want to play for you called Reframe, which is our conversation with some of the leading experts in the United States about the challenge of learning to read and what we got to do.
When kids aren't learning to read, I mean, why are we even doing anything else?
Why isn't it that kids, when they come to school, and they do need to learn math, so I don't want to discount math, but why isn't the greater percentage of their day spent learning how to read?
Why aren't we pulling out all the stops and saying, wait a minute, you know what, if you don't learn to read, there are so many disastrous consequences. I mean, it would not be a good idea for kids never to get their early grounding in science or social studies. But I don't know that the life consequences would be anywhere nearly as dramatic as they are for kids that don't learn to read.
You don't find people running around with a sense of urgency. We're killing our children. Do you know how many dropped out today? Why don't we do something? There's no, it's all, people are going to meetings.
It feels very frustrating that we're not seeing the kind of change we want to see in improvements in reading achievement. And it's hard to understand why that's happening.
People really need to have a wake-up call here, which is that reading is essential. And in fact, it's one of the inability of people to read, our young people to read, is one of the greatest risks that we all face today.
The problem is our society's lack of insight into what is involved in acquiring literacy.
That's my favorite single quote. 400 plus hours of conversation with 120 plus different scientists, and she nails it the best. She was part of the National Institute of Child Health Human Development Senior Scientist Research Team on Understanding Reading Problems. And her conclusion after 10 years of working there and summarizing 20 years of research was that we think we understand what reading is, we think we understand how to teach it, us adults that are good at it, and it is our assumptions about what it is that's causing the problem.
So when we think we're going to fix the reading problem in the country by teaching beginning reading in a particular way, we're fooling ourselves.
Adults who enjoy reading, most of us do, reading is a pleasurable experience. It's something that brings us comfort. It's very difficult for us to relate to a child who struggles so much with that process.
People in decision-making roles have to essentially have a lot of imagination to see the world from the eyes of somebody who has a lower level of literacy, because literacy is something we have taken for granted. We've pretty much always had it as long as we could remember.
It's like any skill. Once you've acquired it, it seems easy. It seems natural. I think parents, children, teachers don't appreciate how extraordinarily difficult this is.
If I had my druthers, instructional methods wouldn't be the big deal out there. What would be the big deal is if teachers could ask themselves, what is it?
So the interesting thing is that the consensus of experts is that what we've got to do is change the way that the adults who are involved with kids who are struggling with reading think about the challenge, think about what reading is. And that's really difficult because it's second nature to us. But exactly because it's second nature, we no longer have a direct first-person experience of the struggle that children are experiencing. We have mental models about it. We have ideas. We have competing ideologies and methodologies and products and concepts about how to teach. But they're all on the adult side. They're all on the other side of being proficient, looking back upon the child and then imposing a model based on that adult thinking, based on that adult proficiency with this, imposing a model back upon the children. We're no longer experiencing what they're experiencing. And what's being called for is a radical reformation in how we think about this. And that's partly what I'm going to be sharing with you today. So what this has led us to is to say, in order to get at reformation of our thinking about reading, we really have to start with a different purpose or a different ground having to do with learning itself. So what I'm going to do is take a few minutes of our time now and go down a different track and talk about learning. What isn't affected by our learning? I mean, what isn't? What aspect of a human development and experience and function? It's involved in our physical health. If you look at what it is that causes all of our healthcare crisis, our problem, how many of those things are a result of neurobiologically innate disease and disorder as opposed to diseases and disorders that are a consequence of learned behavior? I mean, the innate is dwarfed by the learned. The same thing is true with emotional health. When we look at what is it that goes on in the psychological well-being of children, the majority of the problems that they're having aren't necessarily preordained. They didn't come that way. They learned that. And one of the keys here, the way that I like to think of it is that not only do I learn, I am learned in that there's very little about me that isn't been shaped, formed, directed by my learning. I am learned. It affects everything about who we are, how we think, how we function individually and collectively. It is ultimately, when you look at the healthcare crisis or the global ecological crisis or national security or any of the things that we face, individual challenges or collective challenges, they all come down to the problems are caused by unhealthy learning, and the solutions all involve a different approach to learning. One of the ways that brings this out, I think probably the best, is just to look at some of the differences. I mean, the difference between the caveman and a stone and the scientist is not neurobiological, it's not genetic. It's all learned. The difference between people gathering around and having a little dialogue, you know, 5,000 years ago and a massive political rally today is learning. The difference between the beginnings of science and putting a robot on Mars is learning. It's not in our brains per se as a biological phenomena. It's not in our genes. It's in our collective transmission of our learning. Learning is at the heart of everything. More than any other single thing we care about or pay attention to, learning is involved in everything. What does this mean? It means we can no longer assume that what we think kids should learn is more important than how well they can learn. That once you get to a point where the rate of change is complex and as fast as it is today, there's nothing we have to teach, nothing that's more important than how well they can learn in general. And that's very simple, but that's very radical. Because I, in my course, I've probably talked to 1,000+ kids over the past 15 years or so doing this kind of work. And asking them, do you think that your teachers or your parents are more concerned with how well you're learning, how well you're participating in your learning from the inside out, or what it is they're trying to teach you? I've never had one child say that that they felt that their teachers and parents were more concerned with how well they were learning. I mean, it's 180 degrees out of phase with the way education has evolved as a system. And the interesting thing, and I think probably the most, one of the most powerful connections in all this, is that if you deconstruct any learning challenge, a math problem, anything that requires understanding, that requires them to work into an understanding and say, what's the best possible path to get somebody who's struggling to learn something to learn it? It's to meet them on the edge and steward the quality of their participation in the learning. Yeah? I mean, to the extent that we're not doing that, then again, we're treating them like coma patients, moving their minds around like we might move the body of a coma patient around, hoping that, well, that will be better than nothing. So in order to make this kind of shift, to actually become concerned with how well children are learning, actually operate in what we're doing as if how well they're learning is what we most have to steward, what we most have to guide, what we most have to bring forth. That the mission of education, the central mission of education, is to bring forth really healthy learning in each child. Child that can learn what they need to learn, when they need to learn it as they go forward. This is not an argument against curriculum. Obviously, kids will not choose to learn the things that they need to learn that are foundational to being successful in the world. So it's not as simple a dichotomy as to say, well, because we're going to concern ourselves with learning, we're going to throw the curriculum out the door. We still have to do the curriculum, but we have to look at each thing that we're doing, each aspect of our interaction with a child through the curriculum, as if its purpose is to use the curricular content as an exercise environment, like a gymnasium, like the weights in a machine, the main purpose of which is to exercise the quality of their participation, because it is that quality of their participation, how well they learn in general, that's going to have more of an influence on the future of their lives, emotionally, academically, on the job, in relationship with their family, with their peers, with their friends, than anything you have to teach them. One of the ways to get into that conversation is to recognize that one of the problems that we have with the way we approach learning is we tend to think of it as if it's a utility. We tend to think of learning as this thing that humans do in order to gain more knowledge. It's kind of a hangover from the days of Bacon, right? Francis Bacon, knowledge is power. Well, the reality is the power of knowledge is how well it resources ongoing learning. It's not terminal. So we have to stop thinking of learning as just a utility for the acquisition of knowledge, skills, and experience, and instead as the central dynamic that we use knowledge and experiences to exercise. One of the next important points in all of this is to recognize a difference between healthy and unhealthy learning. Because not all learning is healthy. We say that healthy learning is learning that results in internal mental scaffolding that extends the ability to learn. But as you've all experienced with children who had difficulty, perhaps it's in reading, perhaps it's in math, they picked up some kind of a guessing game, some kind of a strategy, right? And now that they've learned that strategy is working against them efficiently learning thereafter, right? So that strategy is unhealthy to their ongoing learning. So there's cognitive... there's certain kinds of learning that we could say is cognitively unhealthy. It sets the kids on a path of function that's not efficient for ongoing learning. But the more important and most significant form of unhealthy learning is emotional. As we'll see as we talk more about the reading, the case of reading, which is a great exemplifier of all of this conversation we're having, is that children can develop unconscious emotional aversions. And you've seen it, you've all seen it in your classroom, right? Where kids get frustrated, they get confused, they feel bad about themselves, and their entire interior being is trying to avoid that feeling. And that is learning disabling, right? It's disabling, it's disconnecting, it's causing them to unconsciously avoid learning. So the point here is that once we start concerning ourselves with stewarding the health of learning as if that's our central mission, and I submit to you that it is, and take all challenges and arguments to go into that, you know, after this event by email and phone and whatever. Once we get through that, then the next point is this distinction between healthy and unhealthy learning. And then after that is the distinction that's really critical that for the most part adults don't really get, which is the difference between artificial and natural modes of learning. Let me get us started with that one little video.
The Nurse Neighborhoods report was very emphatic in stating that children are born ready to learn. We don't have to make them ready to learn. We don't have to teach them how to learn. They are kind of wired from the beginning to learn, and they're wired to experience and to master the world around them.
That guy, by the way, was the chief editor of the Neurons to Neighborhoods report, which was a summary of all known neuroscience in the world relative to early childhood development. How does the brain develop? And one of the number one findings was, we don't have to teach these kids how to learn. They come wired for learning. They come learning oriented. We have a learning instinct. Our learning instinct, our orientation to be learning, to extend ourselves into the worlds we inhabit by learning, is what makes us human more than any other thing. So on the one hand, we come that way. On the other hand, this next person is the person at Stanford's Hoover Institute, who is responsible for studying the macro patterns of effectiveness in school and what should schools be doing.
What is important about education? It's not that somebody knows the current science, because the current science might be wrong, but it's that somebody knows how to learn about new science and adapt to do something that they had never even thought about doing when they were in school. That's the key element.
So the key element is to produce students that are capable of learning about things that we can't even imagine at the time we're educating them. So on the one hand, you've got one group of scientists studying the brain coming into the world saying it's learning oriented. On the other hand, we've got systems studying what does an education have to do, and it says we have to continue that learning orientation. That's the purpose. But the difference is that the first group of scientists are talking about natural organic learning. Children come into the world naturally learning oriented. And what I mean by that is they come, there's a term called proprioception or self-perception. They come into the world sensing themselves, sensing the very edge of everything they're doing. And that's the core of their learning dynamic. So this is most evident, for example, in walking. That's my favorite part. So, if you can see the baby's kind of gravity surfing right there, right? It's sensing the edge of its own experience, live, right now, not later, right now, right on the edge. It senses itself start to fall, and it is the differentiating the sense of falling and moving so as to not fall that propels walking. It's not some kind of computer-like little script that's being run. It's a three-dimensional, acoustical, live, felt sense process. And that's the miracle of early human learning. This is the same thing as true how a child comes into language, learning to talk, learning to differentiate sound. So the child would never learn to talk if after it said something, right, it took it a quarter of a second to hear what it said. The baby would never learn to walk if after it started to feel itself falling, it took a half a second for it to realize that, right, it had fallen. It's designed to pay exquisite attention to the edge of now as it's extending into greater capability. And the same is true with learning how to manipulate a physical object. So this is the center of organic, natural human learning, which is to differentiate and extend on the living edge of right now. The problem is that everything about the way that the world works is about the not now. It's about the complex, abstract not now. And there's nothing in the organism that comes wired for that. So the challenge of education is to bridge this natural, organic, powerful, awesomely powerful learning capability that every human being is born with, and bring that into the artificial learning environments that we're not wired for, that's virtualized, that's mental, that's abstract, that doesn't have feedback on the edge like walking and talking and touching does. That leads us back to a conversation about reading. Because reading is the best example, the best case of this artificial learning environment. It's completely artificial. In fact, the way we like to think of it is reading is a code-informed and instructed simulation of language. It's like a player piano. All happening in the brain, taking a code and using the code through all kinds of machinery to play these little sound elements and to do it at just the right speed and just the right way to result in an internal experience of language. And just imagine, if you will, a player piano where some of the keys were stuck. The music would become unintelligible, or if it wouldn't run fast enough. Speed is a key issue in all of this.
In silent reading, you typically move your eyes about every 250 milliseconds. Okay, that's about the average fixation time of the eye. But there's a lot of variability around that. Sometimes it's as short as 100 milliseconds, sometimes it can be as long as 500 milliseconds. And the variability is being largely driven by things related to how easy or difficult it is to process the word that you're looking at.
See, that? Notice the difference between how he's talking and how fast those words are moving? There's a temporal relation, which is called a temporal profile. There's a relationship between the speed of language and the speed that reading has to happen in order for reading to work. It's incredibly fast. The average time that the brain has to work the letter into a sound is less than a tenth of a second. Less than a tenth of a second. Let me give you another little example. Anybody get this? No. How about now? No. How about now?
We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union...
I'm sorry about that particular sound clip. I spent a lot of time before I came here weeding out all of the American references I could, but I forgot about that one. But it makes the point, right, that there's this narrow window. If it's not moving at a certain speed, it's not intelligible to us. And reading is the similar problem in that it has to take this code and convert this code into a simulation. It's a virtual reality experience. It's virtual reality one. We all take it for granted, like I was saying, but it's as completely as artificial as a modem, a toaster, a DVD player, the projector that's projecting on the screen is a great analogy, right? It's taking this code and turning that into a representation and projecting that into consciousness. And there's a lot of different things that can go wrong with that process that result in difficulty for children. There's so many things involved. There's the innate differences in the kind of neurobiological wiring that children come with. So the argument would be that somewhere between 1 and 5%, depending on the expert you talk to, of children that struggle with reading are struggling because of some kind of difference in their innate neurobiology. Of course, if you double click on that, no scientist can tell what's really neurobiological from what's environmentally caused, because our instrumentation can't peer that subtly in to what's going on in infants. So it's a guesstimate. The 1 to 5% is what falls off the backside, and we say, well, we don't seem to be able to reach and help people. There's about 95% we can reach, therefore what's left, but they must have something innately wrong. But we don't know that for sure. There's problems with parents. In other words, there's an almost direct correspondence between adult literacy and child literacy. The more the children are growing up in an environment where the adults are low literate or that are avoiding literate practices for any number of reasons, which we'll touch on some more as we go forward, then they're creating an environment that's unconsciously cueing the child away from literacy. So parents play a big role. Preschools, all these things contribute to whether a child is ready. In addition to that, there's exposure. How much are they read to? Typical things that everybody's aware of. How many books are around the house, newspapers, magazines? Is there literacy practices happening generally in the house? Here in your district, as in different number of places that I visited in the United States, one of the big problems is the gap in language. The fact that so many children's basic natural oral language of origin is different than the English that we're trying to teach them to read with. And the greater the gap, the greater the difficulty, the greater the confusion. What I'm suggesting is that the core of the reading problems, there's three things to pay attention to. One, the child's level of readiness. Two, the inherent confusion that's involved in learning to read. And three, the shame, and which we're going to kind of close on, which is the most important point in a way. Let me talk about the confusion for a moment and come back to some of these things that make it worse, ranging from what's called, what some other people call dysteachia, which is connected to teacher training, which is connected to social inertia and resistance to change, which is connected to superficial thinking. I mean, there's so many factors involved here. But let's go to the heart of it for a moment and just talk about the confusion.
How do you feel when you read?
My brain hurts.
It hurts?
My brain is start. My head start hurting. It's like it kept on boom, 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 boom. Just beating. I didn't even know the word. I don't even know what's going on in my head. I didn't. I was like, what is this word? I can't figure it out.
It's pretty difficult, like putting sounds to these symbols, knowing the difference between one and another, and knowing that some are numbers and some are letters, and that you can put them together and they form a whole completely different thing.
I get confused a lot because I'll sit there and I get frustrated. It's no fun. I don't like reading.
And I can't understand what it's saying.
We're talking about children experiencing a form of confusion that's unnatural to the organism.
I think that's a interesting and good way to frame things.
Well, in English, get the hook.
I knew the letter names. It was like the sounds and the bigger words. And the words that, like, when you sign them out, they aren't pronounced the way they sound.
I mean, I'm sounding them out like I've been taught, but it just ain't, I don't know, it just don't work. Because, you know, they tell you to sound out, and then, you got vowels, and some of them are silent, and it's just like, well, these two work together to make this thing, and it's like, huh? I mean, it's just like, it's so confusing.
See, C, S, Ch, Sh. O, ow, ah, wa, oo. M, P, p. A, ah. R, r. I-E-E. S-S-Sh-Z. O-A-A-W-A-U. N-N.
Inconsistencies, absurdities, facts contrary to the etymology that show up in the writing system, it's a mess.
It's a real puzzle, and it's a very arbitrary exercise in orthography to figure out what's what.
Who came up with E-N-O-U-G-H spells enough?
Why do I have one tooth and several teeth, and I go into a restaurant and sit in one booth, and there aren't several beef?
Of, by F, I don't hear F making V.
sounds very often, and it doesn't. In fact, it only does it in of.
I don't know of anything that has more exceptions than reading in English. I mean, English seems to be a total monster.
I suspect that most letters that are in your sort of foveal zone or the area right around your fixation are probably being processed pretty much in parallel. So I don't think we need to think of them as, you know, one 25 millisecond, another 25 milliseconds, but averaged over them,
yeah,
it's going to be about 25 milliseconds. Yeah, very fast, staggeringly fast.
Our son. Compower son. Compact son. Compact. Son. Compower son. Comparison. I hate this word.
That's the majority of our kids who have a tough time. They are slow. They are labored in their reading. They are they're hitting the wall on a lot of these print skills.
The truth is that reading is one of the more complicated of the higher cognitive functions, using attention and rate of processing and sequencing and memory and the linguistic systems and the visual system, and it having to coordinate this dance that's going on. And the more complicated the translation from the orthography to the phonology is in a particular language, the more complicated this processing dance has to be within the brain.
What has to happen is your phonological processor, your orthographic processor, your meaning processor, and your context processor all have to work in concert to identify the written word.
It's an enormous task just to get started, just to go to square one to be able to use the machine, so to speak, in this case, reading and writing.
It's hard won by incredible depth of practice. It's very unsurprising that many people struggle with it.
We should be astonished that so many people do learn to read an alphabetic writing system with relatively inexpert instruction. That's what's remarkable.
So, this is an artificial form of confusion, right? What I'm suggesting is that these kids, for reasons having to nothing to do with anything about themselves, having to do instead with this ladder that they've been climbing since birth, that involves the interplay of their brains, you know, the genes, the expression of genes in their brain and the environment, that involves this kind of sensitive plastic slope during which it's incredibly precarious how the brain develops if it's not exposed to sufficient language. The relationship between emotion and cognition, whether the child, as they're growing up, develops a kind of emotional resiliency, or, put in another word that I don't like as much, a high positive self-esteem, right? If they're weak in terms of emotional resiliency, if they haven't had enough word exposure when they were little, if they haven't had enough rich, engaging conversation to exercise the kind of mental powers and processes and sound distinctions, then they're going to have trouble with reading. It's got nothing to do with anything that's their fault. And on top of that, what we're talking about, again, is preparing children to deal with this confusion that we wouldn't let any computer in the world run a piece of code like this. Yet, the children who struggle with this.
Why does our analysis always come down to, well, let's fix these kids?
This guy, Galen Alessi, did this paper in which he diagnosed diagnosis. And what he did was he took a case studies for about 1,000 kids that were diagnosed as having specific learning disability. So he presented those who provided the diagnosis with a number of questions, like, why are kids diagnosed? And he had a whole bunch of options, including inappropriate teaching, school program, failure to identify like problems in a timely manner. And it was never any of the above. It was always the kid. The kid was always the problem, and never was the establishment responsible for the problem.
We keep looking for the source of the problem in the child. What's the deficit in the child? Damaged neurology, you know, a lack of motivation, bad home environment, small vocabulary, attention deficit disorder.
Vast majority of the assessment that occurs is focused almost entirely on the child. So the failure is localized at the level.
As if there's something wrong with them.
As if there's something wrong with the child, and only with the child.
Rather than the child.
As though there might not be something wrong.
This whole system.
Right, with the system, with the curriculum that the district's chosen, with the way that the instruction is delivered in that particular classroom, with the way the parents have responded to the student's failure. There are all of these other parties that share a role in shaping this child's behavior. And that's not to suggest that it's necessarily productive or useful to point fingers at anyone, but it's certainly unfair to assume that all of the responsibility for that failure rests on that child's head, the person least equipped to bear the responsibility.
It's just, it's always put me in a point where I've...
So I went to a good school, but I still struggle. There must be something wrong with me. What happens to kids that grow up feeling there's something wrong with their minds? When you think of reading as this faster than you can possibly think about unconscious assembly process, right? I mean, when reading works good, the only thing we're paying attention to is the other side of comprehension. We're reflecting on what it is that we're hearing or knowing or thinking on the other side of reading. We can't bring cognitive attention to the working out of word recognition, or the whole thing stutters up. But the reason that we'd have problems with that are because of this code, which is another story that those of you that join me for the afternoon or the breakout sessions will talk about the history of that code and how it relates to the brain process stutter that's at the core of reading difficulties. But know that the consequence of this, despite all these variables, despite the superficial thinking, the debate between phonics and whole language, which are superficial compensational processes for dealing with this underlying mess, despite the resistance in education, despite the differences in media, the fact that kids today have got a world full of complex, rich, intellectually stimulating opportunities don't require any of the work that learning to read does. There's all these things that make it more difficult than ever for a child to learn to read. But here's the thing is that children who struggle with this come away with the sense that the struggle means there's something wrong with their brains, there's something wrong with their minds. And the consequence of that, and kind of the main thing that we want to talk about, is shame. Let me ask a brief question. What is the number one thing adult human beings are afraid of? I heard it, public speaking, right? Public speaking. Yeah. I feel that every time. And despite the fact that public speaking is the number one thing that adults are afraid of, and when we say that we're afraid of it, what are we really afraid of? Is it the act of the speaking? The embarrassment, right? And what is embarrassment? It's another word for shame. At the deepest level, if we use the most concise language, the core of embarrassment is shame. Shame is a biological emotion. It's not a complex cognitive mix. It's right at the core of us, right? Like fear and anger. There's in the affect science, there's 9 of them, and shame is one of them. And shame is a learning prompt to the animal part of us, but it has no business interrupting things like complex unconscious assembly processes associated with this code. This is a kind of a story that exemplifies the power that shame has on human beings. Looked
like lines and circles and squiggles. I had no idea where the words were. The teacher began hassling me because I wasn't able to read. And by the end of October, the kids were making fun of me because I couldn't read. And I realized it wasn't going to be too long before my mom and dad found out that I wasn't doing my job. He said, so I was scared. I was really scared. He said, but I was also a real resourceful kid. And I looked around the room and I noticed there was another kid in the class who couldn't read. This kid couldn't read a lick. And yet nobody made fun of him because he couldn't read. And the teacher didn't hassle him because he couldn't read because he was deaf. He wore a hearing aid. He had a hearing loss. And because he was deaf, no one expected him to read on time. He said, so I figured in my six-year-old mind, the solution to my problem was to convince everyone that I was deaf. And if I could convince everyone I was deaf, they'd stop hassling me about the reading. He said, so I went on a one-man campaign to convince everyone in my life that I couldn't hear. He said, and everything was fine until June. I said, well, what happened in June, Dan? He said, my mom and dad sat me down the last day of school in June in the first grade and said, Dan, we're really worried about your hearing. You don't seem to be able to hear. We've taken you to hearing doctors and audiologists all over Cape Cod. Nobody can figure out what it is. So we've made an appointment for you. And you're going to go to Boston Children's Hospital next week. And you're going to stay there for 4 days and three nights. And they're going to do exploratory ear surgery and have your adenoid surgically removed. And this six-year-old kid went through 3 days of surgery rather than tell his parents what he had done. Can you imagine the trauma of a six-year-old child going through surgery that only he knows he didn't need?
The National Center for Learning Disabilities, we have a wonderful...
Now that may seem strange, but if you look back in your own personal history and you're honest with yourself and you think about the times that you've done things to avoid the feeling of shame, they're right up there. We all do it. Shame is a feeling we do not want to feel. And whereas it can be a helpful thing to motivate us to learn to behave in ways that won't cause the shame when it's a kind of a gross social behavioral thing, when it gets down, when it infects what's happening in this kind of deep, faster than conscious cognitive process, it's fundamentally learning disabling. What happens when, just as this kid was avoiding telling the parents, right? What happens when you feel ashamed of your mind when you're in learning context, when you get near something that causes you to feel confused and that triggers this shame? What happens to the general health of your learning? So what I'm suggesting is that the very core emotional intelligence of the organism that we are is capable of developing unconscious emotional avoidance system to avoid being confused because it causes us to feel shame. But once somebody develops something like that, once they develop a shame avoidance to confusion, it's fundamentally learning disabling. And this is caused, remember I asked the question about the number one fear being public speaking? This is caused because children are put into situations where they're having to publicly perform while doing something they don't feel good about.
Being asked to read out loud in front of a class, which is a very typical elementary school reading activity, can be a terribly humiliating situation.
My teacher asked me to come into the front of the class and read a book, and everybody was just staring at me, and I got real nervous because I didn't want to mess up or anything. And then when I started reading, I started messing up, and I just couldn't help it, and everybody started laughing at me and stuff, so.
Like, the teacher would ask me to read something, and I would read it, and I'll get a wrong word, or I'll go too slow, and they'll make fun of me.
I kept messing up on the words, and people kept laughing at me.
They said that you don't know how to read. I bet you won't be able to how to read when you grow up.
They always laugh at me if I get twisted up with words. It makes my heart drop because it seems like they're not my friend no more.
Ever since then, I've been comfortable reading in front of people, and they made fun of me and stuff, so I just never really liked to read after that.
I don't like reading
out loud. So, readiness, everything depends on how ready a child is. Then the confusion, the job of educators to create a conductive path that's individually differentiated to the level of that child's readiness through this incredible confusion. Because what we're talking about is the entire life trajectory of a child through school and thereafter into life being endangered by whether or not their early life learning trajectory and the way instruction meets them will get them over this obstacle course wall in such a way that reading becomes as transparent as listening and speaking. The other thing that's important to kind of ground here is that I'm not talking about just kids that can't read at all. I'm talking about kids that have a struggle with it, who are unable to read at the level that's let's put it this way. Every child who is not able to read in a way that's as transparent to meaning as speaking and listening is in danger. Because the entire world of parents, teachers, the peers is causing them to feel like the fact that they can't do this means there's something wrong with them. And this contributes. Again, in our breakout sessions, we're going to talk about the source of the confusion and how that relates to the core brain challenge. But in our remaining moments, the thing that I want to stress is that, like you heard the guy say, they put the goggles on the people and are monitoring how reading is happening in the brain. This is this incredibly precarious, high-speed assembly process that has to happen in the brain. And the biggest part of the time delay that's taken the brain so much time, and the reason there's a stutter that you hear in the voice of a struggling reader, you hear their voice drop out as they're reading, is that their brain is caught trying to process through this confusion. So that's bad enough, and that's the biggest problem, but it's exacerbated by what we call the downward spiral of shame. And I want to come all the way back now and link this into the conversation we had about stewarding the health of learning. Because remember, as much as I'm on about reading, the conversation about reading isn't about reading per se. It's that reading exemplifies the problem of learning in general. What happens to children who experience protracted difficulty in learning something is that if we're not careful, if we're not sensitive, if we're not tracking, if we're not primarily concerned with how well they're learning rather than how well we're pushing the model we think we should teach, then we're creating a context in which they can come to feel, again, like there's something wrong with them. And this becomes this downward spiral that ultimately becomes learning disabling. It could be math. I mean, math is the next thing up. It's also a code, right? So it's children of the code could extend into there. It's an artificial, abstract, conventional, technological invention of adult human beings imposed on little ones. And what we're talking about in all these cases is ambiguity, confusion, overwhelmed with confusion, which leads to a stutter in the flow of processing in the brain, which causes a pop-up in self-consciousness. The child becomes aware, oh, here I am struggling, which leads to shame because of the self-blame. And once the shame kicks in, and this is a really critical part, most people think of shame and emotion as this side issue, separate from the kind of cognitive learning tasks that we're all on about. But this is cognitive in the sense that once the shame kicks, the brain is now busy with the shame and there's less brain available to do the work that caused them to feel shame in the first place. So this is fundamental to cognitive ecology in learning, not just a wouldn't it be nice or unfortunate emotional consequence. So there's a dissipation of the process, which leads to a just disentrainment, a fallout of the flow. Dropping out from being able to stay in reading, which is very frustrating, which causes the child to blame themselves. The more that they blame themselves, the easier it is to go to shame. The more that they go to shame, the more they want to avoid the shame. The more that they want to avoid the shame, the more that they start to develop a self-image and a way of talking to themselves that protects them, and they start saying, I'm stupid, I'm no good, I'll never get that. Which are all protective mechanisms to protect themselves from how bad it feels, and which all leads to them avoiding whatever that learning challenge is, in this case, reading. So what can be done about this? What I want to leave you with is that the most important single thing that you can do is be a first-person learner, not a robotic extension to some protocol of how to teach, but a first-person learner, somebody who's on the, who's actually exhibiting in your personal practice, in your interaction, in your interfacing with children. You're learning your way all the time to be an ever better dancer on the edge of their learning. To be able to give them, one of my favorite metaphors is helping a baby learn to walk, you know, where you give them the two fingers, and you're not pushing them, you're not pulling them, you're not directing them, you're not driving them, you're just giving them an extra reference to sense themselves and extend themselves and to move themselves. And so there's no substitute for your first person learning. So, with respect to reading, like I said, we'll talk some more about that as for those of you that are interested and go into the down the rabbit hole of where does this code come from and what are its challenges in terms of generating this simulated language experience. In closing, I would just like to say that I really appreciated the opportunity to be here and to talk with you. You'll notice at the back of the room there's little feedback cards. If you take one of these cards, it's got my website address. I've only shared with you maybe 5 or 6 little video clips out of 70 that are available on this website that deal with a variety of things that we've only been able to scratch the surface of. And if you go there and send me feedback about your experience of this, which will help me learn to do this better, spread this message, then I'll send you this electronic book, PDF book, that covers the full scope of this conversation and some other things. So, I thank you very much for hearing me out. I appreciate it. I wish you great luck.
Your message today was just as powerful and important as the one that I heard back in November. You have reminded us that we need to continue to meet our learners where they are at, not where we wish they would be. Their literacy levels and self-esteem are inextricably intertwined, and that sometimes our students feel shame towards their lack of learning and progress in our schools. The student who is our struggling learner is someone who is in constant emotional and cognitive danger, and you have vividly pointed out that the longer our children and adults continue to struggle with their acquisition of literacy, the more they seriously impair their overall learning and growth. You provide us with a pathway, a direction to follow to maximize the potential of our students. You have made a positive impact on our collective and professional opinions, and for this we are thankful. I'm also thankful that your breakout sessions are in the 600-seat Michael J. Fox Theater, as I anticipate that many of us will want to hear your presentation on the code and the challenge of learning and intervening. On behalf of the Joint Professional Development Committee and the entire school district, we thank you for your contributions to our Professional Development Committee.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And your check is in here, so don't lose that envelope.
Thank you. Thank you all.